This is a production of Cornell University.
So I would like to tell you a story of investigations over many years and with many people. And the question is, why do annual plants die? At the end of the growing season, even though the weather might be perfectly good. This is puzzle botanists for many years. Probably the first person to publish about this was Hans Mollisch, who was a professor in Prague and Vienna, and he published a book on the longevity of plants with a lot of data in it. But he concluded that as the lifespan of an annual plant can be prolonged by preventing flowering and fruiting, he suggested that nutrient exhaustion might be the cause, that the plant is running out of nutrients because it's all going to the seeds. So there was another idea around, and this derived from experiments by Carl Leopold, who some of you may remember. He spent a good many years of his career here at Cornell, the Boyce Thompson Institute. And some research he did quite a long time ago, he pointed out that if you deflower male spinach plants here, you would prevent senescence. But as the flowers of male spinach plants are so small, they can't possibly be taking nutrients from the plant, and therefore this led to the idea of a senescence factor, a death hormone, if you like, coming out of the flowers or fruits and causing the death of the whole plant. And one of the chief proponents of this over the years has been professor at Michigan, Larry Nuden. He's now retired, but at many conferences he gave data which he claimed supported this idea. However, in my opinion, he never produced any concrete evidence for such a factor. He never identified it and said it was always this nebulous senescence factor. So I started thinking about this problem many years ago and couldn't think how to tackle it, but I read an article put out by the college in one of their newsletters by Cowles, and it was an article by Jerry Marks at Geneva. And Jerry Marks was a professor in horticultural sciences at Geneva, and he was a pea geneticist. And he reported in this internal article in Cal's New York Agriculture or something, that he had a genetic line of peas which senesced in the summer, but did not senesce if he grew it in the winter in the greenhouse. And he named this line of peas Geneva 2 or G2. And this is Jerry at his height up at Geneva working with the peas. Unfortunately, Jerry died what is now many years ago of cancer. So he is no longer with us, but he was probably one of the two prime pea geneticists in the world. Anyhow, here's the peas he had. These are G2 peas. And in these peas, senescence is regulated by day length. So if we have a pea growing in long days, it produces flowers and fruits and dies. And if you grow it in short days, it produces flowers and fruits, but just keeps growing. So we now have a way to investigate senescence by photoperiod and genetics, because all other peas die regardless of day length. So we have a genetic control. So the first thing we did is have a look at this, and we found that indeed the Jerry didn't know what it was. He just knew summer and winter. But if we go back to the original experiments of Garner and Allard on flowering, we realized that it's likely to be photoperiod. So here's the result. This is the number of hours of light per 24 hours. This is the number of reproductive nodes before it dies. And as you see, if you have 13 hours or less of light, it essentially keeps growing ad infinitum. And as you lengthen the day length, the plant produces fewer and fewer nodes before senescence. And this bottoms out at about 10 nodes if you give it 18 hours of light. So it is a photoperiodic response. We found out you couldn't change a short day to a long day just by a flash of light. So it didn't matter if a grad student opened the growth chamber in the middle of the day and shut it again. It was measuring the total amount of light, total photoperiod. And this is the high intensity reaction type of a phytochrome response. My Australian colleagues identified it from light color experiments as a phytochrome response. Now, in these peas, you first see senescence at the apical bud. So I'd like to show you this. This is a G2 grown in short days. And you can see up in the greenhouse up at Goodman. And you can see the vigor of that bud. And by contrast, this is the G2 in long days. And as you can see, the bud has become extremely small and stops growing. And this is the first sign you're going to get that the whole plant is then going to die as the fruits mature. And here's a close-up. This is the short day bud, and this is the long day bud. Just becomes extremely small. And this initial cessation of the growth at the apex has been termed apical arrest. But apical arrest occurs first, then you will have the senescence of the apex, and then the senescence of the whole plant. And in this, I started working closely with colleagues in Australia. And this is Ian Murphy, who came to Cornell on a couple of sabbaticals. So I got to know him well. And he identified the fact that two genes had to be present in the dominant form to get this property. And he named these SN and HR for sterile nodes and high response. And so the G2 is dominant SN, dominant HR. And Jerry Marks had all combinations of these where he could get recessive dominant, dominant recessive, and recessive recessive. And most peas in cultivation are double recessive. So the next thing we need to note is that if you remove the fruits from these plants, they will not senesce even in long days. So here's a short day one. As you can see, it's continuing to grow. Here's a long day one. Growth has ceased. And here is one where all the fruits have been removed. And this is grown in long days, and it keeps growing regardless. If you don't have any fruits, it'll keep growing.
Peter, do the flowers themselves need to be removed, or just once they start fruiting?
Okay, good question. We were removing the flowers, but I'll show you some more data relevant to that. And here's the data on. So the question was, is it the total nutrients that go into the fruit? And so we did this just by dry weight. Fresh weight. So here are the growth rates of all of the fruits in long and short days. And here we cut them off before. I think I should say it's really when they start developing. But it gets more and more intense with time, Don. So this is the growth rates of the fruits. This is the minimum number to induce senescence, and this is the maximum filling. But if we look at short days, where you have the maximum number of fruits, they are growing at a rate that exceeds the minimum growth rate to induce senescence in long days. So the total amount of nutrients going into the fruits does not correlate. So it's not simply nutrients going into the fruit. So if fruit load is not a factor, what is it? And here indeed is a plant with something like 30 pods on it, and yet it's showing no sign of senescence because it's growing in long days. So the total amount of fruits appears to be irrelevant. So at that point, we thought, well, we're going to investigate a senescence factor. If it's a senescence factor that comes out of the fruit, we must be able to trace it from the fruit to the apical bud, because that's where you see the senescence. So what we did, we enclosed the fruit in a gas-tight container, initially glass, later it was plastic, and we put in carbon dioxide. Now, if you look at partitioning, you would expect photosynthate to go from the leaves to the fruit, from the leaves to the apical bud. And if there was some coming out of the fruit to the apical bud, it was probably a small amount. So we said, if we label it with CO2 and we get it labeled with carbon, we're much more likely to see it than if we just look for something that's not labeled. So that was what we did. And here's the data from such an experiment. The fruit here was labeled, and it's being cut off because it was so hot. And here's where the radioactivity went. It primarily went to the same side as the fruit. These are the leaves as we go up. These are the fruits. Sorry, these are the fruits. So radioactivity comes out of that fruit and goes to the other fruits, primarily on the same side because of the vascular connections, but we get them all the way up. And this is the amount in the apical bud. So indeed, some will go from the treated fruit to the apical bud. Therefore, a senescence factor is a possibility. So we then looked at the data comparing long days and short days. And this is the growth stage. The labeled fruit is 50% elongated, fully elongated, 30 to 50% filled. And this is the amount exported from the fruit as compared to the total amount fixed. So it's a very small amount comes out. This is short days and long days. This is the amount that goes to the plant. This is the amount that ends up in the apical bud. So to cut a long story short, there is much more going to the apical bud in short days than in long days, on the order of at fully elongated, about 10 times as much. So the figures don't match what you would expect if a senescence factor was coming out in long days. There's more transport of carbon in short days. And here's what happens to this export. What we are doing here, we're allowing the fruits, labeled fruits, and we're allowing them to photosynthesize in radioactive CO2 for 15 minutes and then doing a chase as to where the radioactivity finishes up. And as you can see, a small amount finishes up in the apical bud. A huge amount is actually found in the leaves surrounding the labeled pod. This shoots up, and then we've stopped the radioactivity at this point, and then the radioactivity leaves the leaves and turns up in the other pods. So how does this occur? Well, it turned out that the movement of the radiolabeled material out of the pods is happening in the xylem and not the phloem. So what's happening is that photosynthate comes in solution in the phloem. the amount of water coming in exceeds the transpiration by the fruits, and so the water leaves by the xylem. And we did that with simple experiments killing the phloem. And if you kill the phloem, it makes absolutely no difference. And the reason that the water is leaving is the difference in water potential between the fruits and the surrounding leaves. So during the day, here's long days. This is negative bars. If you want negative megapascals, divide by 10. This is the water potential of the fruits in long days, and this is the water potential of the leaves. This is dark. This is the day. This is dark. And during the day, the leaves lose water, their water potential drops, so you have a movement of water from the fruits to the leaves. And that's what's happening. And this occurs also in apples and things like that. So the amount of water going into a fruit in the phloem exceeds the transpiration. And you can see the same in apples. You can see the change in size between the beginning of the day and the end of the day, or the midday. An apple shrinks because the water is going out to the leaves. So we then identified the radioactivity that was coming out of the fruits. What is it? We tracked it down, and it is 73% is sucrose, which is probably not surprising. Some of what came in left, but it's also 16% by GC mass spec was malic acid. How come we get malic acid? Well, it turns out that the pods of peas also have C4 photosynthesis. Not the leaves, but the pods do. So there's some malic acid in the being produced in the pods. That's from the literature, by the way. I can see Klaus with a big frown on his face, but that's from the literature. I didn't go and investigate it. So we've got 89%, and no other major compound could be found. So these are unlikely, in my opinion, senescence factors. They don't correspond with it in long days either. And so my conclusion is fruit-derived senescence factors do not exist. Okay, so I've already told you fruit load is not the factor. I've told you a senescence factor doesn't exist. So what are you left with? Well, it turns out that it requires a bit of observation. But I mean, look at this plant, 30 fruits and still not senescing. What the heck's going on? Well, we've been staring at this for years, it turns out, without sort of realizing basic plant morphology. You have to just look at the plant and see what's happening. And the thing is that the rate of development of the flowers and fruits is much more rapid in long days than short days. So here's the tip of G2 peas grown in short days and long days. And I want you just to look at the difference here. Here, the bud up, that's a flower bud, up in the apical bud, it's extremely small. And even down here, you're not really getting much of a development of the fruit. By contrast, look at the long days. Look at the flower bud there. There's a huge flower bud there. The flower buds are growing much more rapidly in long days than short days. And the fruits, you see a fruit there, fruit there, fruit there, already elongating while there's no sign of anything happening here. So we have a speed of development factor. And so I should point out that this work is carried out by many students over the years, and I'll give you their names at the end. But here's the results of one of them. What she was doing is looking at the percent of assimilates from the leaves transported to the apical bud, comparing two different lines, one that is double recessive and then the G2. The amount going to the apical bud is virtually the same. in long and short days in the double recessive, and the amount is fairly low. By contrast, in G2, the amount going to the vegetative tissue in short days in the apical bud is much greater. And this is where the leaf that was treated, different leaves treated at different distances from the apical bud. And so the apical bud, the vegetative tissues, are receiving much more photosynthate than is the case in long days. So we now have a difference in the amount of material going to the apical bud. And then within, if we look at comparing the flower buds and the vegetative tissue within the apical bud, and student Maureen Kelly did the dissections. So this is expressing the radioactivity in the flower buds and the radioactivity in the young leaves. So if this is high, it indicates that there's a shift to reproduction. So here we are, G2, here's the ratio in short days when there's no senescence, here's the ratio in long days when there's senescence. There is a shift from the vegetative to the reproductive tissue. And here is one of the, this is I2, is dominant SN recessive HR. So there's more shift of resources to the reproduction in long days when you're going to get senescence. So the other thing we do in my lab is investigate hormones. And here's what we found. We found early on gibberellin applications could prevent senescence. And an early bioassay showed that there was more bioactive gibberellin in G2Ps in short days and much less in long days. And this was before the pathway of gibberellin biosynthesis had been fully worked out. So we then got to work on identifying these gibberellins. And one of the things I did, I took one of the precursors of gibberellin, namely gibberellin A12 aldehyde, and fed it to pea shoots and asked what it made. And these are HPLC traces, short days here, long days here, half an hour at the bottom of treatment and 6 hours at the top. This is time of elution of an HPLC column. And the most polar compounds come off first, and the least polar compounds come off later. The treating material, GA12 aldehyde, which we had to make, by the way, because you can't buy it. And the way we made it, we fed mevalonic acid to pumpkin, developing pumpkin seeds. So we had to get some pumpkins. And at the time, Ray Sheldrake, some of you in horticulture may remember Ray Sheldrake, had a farm, early bird farm south of Ithaca, and was growing pumpkins. So I contacted Ray and said, can I have a pumpkin? He said, sure. So we shot down to his field to get the pumpkin just at the right size. And there was one really nice pumpkin. So we cut it and we brought it back to the lab, and Ray then let it be known that that was his prize pumpkin, and he had a video camera running on it following the growth of the pumpkin, and suddenly one day his pumpkin was gone. So next year I actually purchased a certain number of plants from Ray. He grew them because my success up at Goodman was pretty pathetic. So we actually had a paid source of pumpkins. So we had to treat the seeds at a very particular time. We didn't treat the seeds. We had to get an enzyme extract, feed it mevalonic acid, and it made gibberellin A12 aldehyde in tiny percent. So, you know, I've just summarized 4 years of work. What I would like you now to take a look at the difference between long days and short days. And if you look at half an hour, you will see there's this peak here, which is very small in long days, much higher in short days. And this turns out to be gibberellin number 53, which is one of the first gibberellins made from GA12-aldehyde. And if we compare again 6 hours, you'll see these are much greater in amount here in short days than here. And these are further gibberellins in the pathway, namely 44, 19, and 20, which probably is gobbledygook to most of you, but I'll explain where they fit in a minute. Here's the amount of radioactivity in GA53 at 1 hour, and here's the amount of radioactivity in 44, 19, and 20 at 6 hours. And in short days in G2, the amount is greater than in long days in G2, which is down the bottom here. So it's almost twice the amount. And so these plants, where they're not senescing, are making more active gibberellins. And here's the gibberellin biosynthesis pathway. And here is GA12-aldehyde. And so these are the succession of gibberellins. And there's my patron saint, Mendel. I was part of a group in the late 1990s that identified this gene here. And we got it out and we sequenced it. And this is the gene that controls Mendel's tallness factor. So tall plants make GA1, and dwarf plants make only 1/20th of the amount because of this gene here, which we show to be gibberellin 3-beta hydroxylase. Anyhow, in my senescence ones, this is the step, the crucial step, that appears to be regulated by photoperiod in G2, and if you up this, you have the potential for making more gibberellin number one, and that is the bioactive gibberellin in peas. So here I am working on this in the Goodman greenhouse with Yuxian Zhu, who was one of the first Chinese to come to Cornell in the plant sciences, and he's now a full professor at Peking University in China and a member of the Chinese National Academy of Sciences. So his task was to analyze the gibberellins in these peas, and this is GA20 content of the vegetative tissue of G2. And you will see that there is a lot more in the vegetative tissue in short days than there is in long days in G2. And then he measured GA1, the bioactive. Oh, GA20 is one before GA1. And here's the amount of GA1 in the vegetative tissue. And again, the amount of GA1 in the vegetative tissue is much higher. And so what is happening is that the gibberellin enhances the growth of the apical, the vegetative tissues in the apical bud, causing them to have a higher sink activity. So here is my conclusion for the mechanisms, or the mechanism of whole plant senescence. It is the diversion of nutrients from the vegetative to the reproductive tissue very early in reproductive development. It is not simply the seeds, that it occurs very early in reproductive development. And when you get this shift to the reproductive tissues, this leads to the senescence of the vegetative tissues. And this is under genetic control. So, what's the evidence for this? Well, the G2Ps senesce only in long days and continues in short days. The flowers and fruits develop more rapidly in long days. And nutrient partitioning from the leaves is more in favor of developing flowers and fruits in long days and in vegetative tissue in short days. And this effect is seen very early on, because I showed you the pictures of the developing flowers. You don't have to wait till the fruit have developed. It's seen very early in reproductive development, so there's a physiological shift, and within the apical bud there's a 10 to 20 fold long day induced shift in photosynthates from the developing from the apical bud to the developing floral buds, and it's the floral buds, not the fruits. And finally, genotypes which senesce regardless of photoperiod display a partitioning similar to G2 in long days. I didn't show you much of the data on that, but that was another whole set of the data. So that's what I think is causing senescence. However, I do not think it's actually photosynthate, because when you're getting senescence of the plant, there's plenty of available starch in the leaf. So it's not photosynthate per se. But this does bring us back to the original experiments by Carl Leopold, where he was getting male spinach plants to senesce, and they have no fruit and no seeds because they're males. Male and spinach is dioecious, male and female plants are separate. So what's happening there? This doesn't fit this idea. So another student went and investigated spinach, and once again, if we look at the architecture, we see the importance of plant morphology. This is a male plant, and while you don't see that in Leopold's photograph, if you look here, look at the number of these are male flowers, look at the number of them. Here are the female flowers, they go on to produce the fruit, but they are very tiny, and look at the difference in amount of leaves. This has very little leaf growth, this has much more leaves, and if we look at the difference in leaves, there you can see them, male on this the left, female on the right. So what happens if you allow these plants to photosynthesize in radioactive CO2? So the plants were treated, a leaf was below the inflorescence, was treated with radioactive CO2, and we asked where the photosynthate went. And this, the top line in all these other graphs is the percent of total export, and this is dividing by the size. So you get, if you like, sink strength down here. So the black is male, and the gray is female, and these are the various tissues, and these are the flowers. So you will notice that the male flowers are in fact taking up a lot of photosynthate. So it's not just all the photosynthate going to flowers and fruits in the female. The male flowers are nutrient hogs, and most of the males in the audience probably like their lunch as well. So this is the amount of radioactivity from a leaf going to the flowers and fruits over a period of time. And this is the number of weeks from the start of flowering. The black are the male, the gray are the female. So look at the amount going to the male here versus the female. The males are in fact nutrient hogs. Why do they not continue? Because at this point the plants die. So it's a short, fast life for the males. The females have a much more prolonged effect, and when later on when the fruits are developing, they do take up more nutrients. But the idea that the males don't take up any nutrients is just not, or photosynthate is just not correct. I'll skip that. So this again fits the idea that it is the diversion of nutrients to the flowers very early in development that starts triggering the senescence process. And I'm just going to add a couple of slides from Xu Sheng. He was good enough to give them to me for this summary talk. If you stop the growth of the apical bud, to get senescence, the lateral buds must always stop growing. Otherwise, you won't get senescence. So here is a wild-type Arabidopsis. And this is one that enables the production of continued cytokinin. I'm right there. Yeah. And if you have cytokinin in the lateral buds, they keep growing. So this one does not senesce. Well, this one does. So it's not just one process. You've got a whole lot of processes going on. And so whole plant senescence consists of three coordinated biological processes. You have the cessation of the growth of the apical meristem. If you can't have the plant continuing to grow. You have the senescence of the somatic organs, such as the leaves. And you need the suppression of the axillary buds. In addition, the whole process is, of course, controlled by genetics. And this is another one of Xu Sheng's plants, where he is using RNAi to knock down a gene associated with senescence. So the whole thing is under genetic control. Now, what is being remobilized from the vegetative tissue to the reproductive tissue? And the evidence is that one of the most important factors is nitrogen. Now, I have not done any work on this, but a lot of papers are now coming out on the remobilization of nitrogen. So I would suggest that this shift very early in reproductive development is a shift in the nitrogen partitioning, because as the leaves senesce, nitrogen is released, and this nitrogen now goes up to either the reproductive tissue or if you're not going to get senescence, to the vegetative tissue. And I've got a couple of diagrams here. I'm not going to go into them, but there's all sorts of schemes, and there's where they came from. But the basic idea is now you have the leaves, the nitrogen reserves in the vegetative organs, and if you're going to get continued growth, these will go up to the new vegetative tissues. But after this shift has occurred, these nitrogen reserves go to the reproductive tissue, leaving the vegetative tissue deficient in nitrogen and probably other compounds so that they do not continue. And so here's a summary slide of what would happen during monocarpic senescence. You start off with vegetative growth. We have the initiation of flowering, and then there is a start of a shift to the flowers at the expense of vegetative growth. And papers are now coming out that suggesting that microRNAs are regulating this process, and this is not anything I'm working on, but this is what recent papers suggest. And this leads to a resource redistribution and the triggering of a senescence program. And part of this is hormonal changes in the different tissues. And you then get a distribution from the vegetative to reproductive growth. So this leads to apical senescence and cell death up at the vegetative tissue. And you see a withdrawal of nitrogen compounds from the leaves associated with leaf senescence. And then you have to have the inhibition of axillary bud growth, and the final result is the overall senescence of the whole plant. So Some work, I worked on peas because a lot of this was done before Arabidopsis became popular. Xu Sheng here in the front row works on Arabidopsis. But I'd like to point out that we need some other models. I'd like to introduce you to the Shus yucca. The Shus yucca is a yucca in the southwestern desert. And in 1952, Gustav Albrecht provided startling photographic proof in the Scientific Monthly that this plant had a remarkable ability to grow extremely rapidly and senesce all within a matter of minutes. So here is the photographs presented. And he claimed that he was taking these at minute intervals, and there it flowers, and now it's senescing. So I want to suggest this as an extremely good model for future examination, because one of the problems with peas, you're waiting for 3 months, and even Arabidopsis, you're waiting for a month, and this would be really a good way of doing it. So after that, I would like to acknowledge the many students over the years who have worked on this, and where they have ended up, and also the many collaborators who joined me in this work on the right side. So actually that's where I'm going to quit that. And so thank you very much for your attention. But I'm going to end show, and I've got hopefully one other little thing for you. Now, one of the pioneers in this field was Carl Leopold. And Carl Leopold continued, he moved mainly into other topics when he was at Cornell, but he was a delightful colleague. And we often went to Senescence conferences together, and together with Brian Shabbat, I see at the back, who also worked on senescence of strawberry mainly, wasn't it? Senescence of strawberry plants. Carl Leopold was a great guitar player. And at various faculty gatherings, he would play his guitar, or also at conferences, he would always, after the banquet, he would get out his guitar, and he liked to play the songs of Tom Lehrer. So he would play I'm a Gnu, but he also played this song called Lobachevsky. And I've discovered that current graduate students don't know these delightful songs, so I'm going to finish off by playing for you Lobachevsky.
Analytical algebraic.
Well, I put that in as to the memory of Carl Leopold, who no questions.
Actually, Peter, I have one. First of all, thank you for a delightful seminar.
Okay.
And memorable. Given the work that you and others did on this G2 clone, has there been research done that has either proved or disproved that there are certain species that are obligate annuals that cannot be manipulated to not senesce?
Well, there's plenty of horticulture varieties where they keep flowering and do not senesce as early as they would in the wild. They've been selected for because gardeners like garden flowers that don't senesce. If you think of your petunias or something like that, they get a bit ratty over the season. But this obligatory sudden shift to senescence has certainly been overcome by genetic selection. Whether there are any that would absolutely keep going, I don't know. Larry Newden had a soybean in his greenhouse that was something like 15 feet high, and he had done it by continually removing the fruits, the flowers and fruits, and it was essentially continuing to grow. But of course, if you now let that flower, it would probably senesce extremely rapidly, because the signal of change in where the resources go seems to intensify with time. So if you've been cutting the flowers and fruits off, you then let it grow just a few, boom, it will immediately put all the reserves in that and senesce. But there's work being done to try and get perennial rice. I don't know what success they have had with that yet.
Thank you.
But I mean, it should be theoretically possible because it's due to gene expression starting up at the beginning of flowering. If you can change that gene expression, you should be able to stop the senescent process.
Chris?
I was wondering if there was work further on the male-female spinach and hormonal signals that might be involved?
Not that I know of. Most people in the field now are either working on nitrogen partitioning or there's some work on microRNAs early on, and then the genetic work of Shusheng, right here, that's where people are going. Not much has been done on the hormones at the present time, but one thing that amazed me, I was at a conference in Denmark in November, and there were papers there with exactly the same phenomenon as I've demonstrated here in rice, and they had no idea what was going on, because graduate students don't read literature if it's older than 5 years, and most of this is older than 5 years. So that's a message to graduate students. Pay attention to some older literature. You can sometimes find the answer there. You can find it by, you know, meiosis, but it may be 10 pages down, because they always start with the latest information.
You know, senescence is a messy business. It comes at the end of a plant's life, and lots of things are deteriorating, as you mentioned, or are just starting to go, and it isn't really clean, except in examples that you show. But my scant experience in rice is that it's one of the few major cereals where the leaves actually stay green, even though the grain is being harvested.
Another area of interest are stay green Newtons. In some of them, however, they found that the leaves stayed green, but photosynthesis declined regardless. So just staying green does not appear to be the entire answer. You have to have something else in addition to staying green. Do you want to comment on that, Shushin?
Sure.
God knows what's going to come up there.
Incriminating evidence.
It's my screensaver, Robbie.
And I'm going to assume that that was your Olympic growing daughter.
Probably, yeah.
And son,
Peter.
So I can get rid of that. Yes.
What comment would you make about tissue sensitivity to these hormones? In terms of, you know, we talk about hormone level, but the converse is sensitive, you know, changing sensitivity of the tissue to these materials going way back.
And absolutely, that is a factor. Nobody, to my knowledge, has measured that. Shusheng, I've never seen any experiments in changing tissue the sensitivity to hormones. Clearly, a good topic for a PhD thesis.
We have run over time, so we're going to need to call it to an end, but certainly if anyone has further issues that they'd like to discuss with Professor Davies, it'll be here. Thank you again.
Okay.
This has been a production of Cornell University, on the web at cornell.edu.